Shalom, everyone. We have a imperative message today. We're going to go into the writings of the Apostle Paul. The New Testament is composed of letters to churches written by the Apostle Paul. So it's a very prominent doctrine or prominent influence in the New Testament. The Christian church is based and founded upon the Apostle Paul, his writings. And contrary to what any of you want to believe, it's not founded upon the gospel of Christ. It's not founded upon that. It's founded upon misinterpretations of the letters of Paul. That's what it's founded upon. And I'm going to show you how the Most High purposely put a spirit on Paul to write his letters in a format that would be a stumbling block to those in the last days. It would be a dividing factor to those that would get into the kingdom of heaven and those that would be that would go into the lake of fire. And a lot of people are going to fall into this trap. I'm going to show you how exactly he did this and why he did this. And it's going to be very clear by the time we go through this lesson. So I'm going to need you to follow me and be attentive. I'm going to need your ears to be attentive. You're going to have to pay attention and follow me. We're going to start from the beginning or near the beginning, and then we're going to work our way up and push to the letters of Paul. And I'm going to show you how the Most High always put traps everywhere. He always put traps to find out where your heart is. And with the letters of Paul, it has nothing to do with his letters per se. It has everything to do with your heart and how you are going to try to interpret his letters to do your will or to do the Most High's will. That's what we're going to find out today. So I'm going to need you to stick with me and push through. I'm Brother Yarashalam. This is the Bible Unlocked, the track of Paul's epistles. Deuteronomy 8, verse 2. And thou shalt remember all the way which the Lord thy God led thee these 40 years in the wilderness to humble thee and to prove thee to know what was in thine heart, whether thou wouldest keep his commandments or no. So the Most High is saying right here that he had the children of Israel wander in the wilderness 40 years on purpose to prove them to see if we would keep his commandments or not. He had the children of Israel wander in the wilderness on purpose for 40 years. It don't take 40 years to walk from Egypt to the land of Israel. It does not take 40 years to walk from that small stretch of space. So the Most High did this on purpose. It was a test. When it says prove thee, that means to test you, to see what you were gonna do in different circumstances, to see if you would keep my commandments or if you're gonna go off and go do your own thing. That's what the whole reason of that's the whole thing behind the 40 years was, to see if you were gonna keep some commandments that I gave to you or if you're gonna go off and go worship somebody else. What did we do? We brought out the golden calf, start worshiping that. We start complaining in the wilderness. So this is what happened as a result of that. Follow me. Deuteronomy 1 verse 34. And the Lord heard the voice of your words and was wroth and swear, saying, surely there shall none of these men of this evil generation see that good land, which I swear to give unto your fathers. So the Most High said, none of the generation, he's referring to the ones that came out of the land of Egypt, the 600,000 souls plus that came on foot out of the land of Egypt. He says, none of these people are going into the land. Why? Because we were complaining. We were not keeping God's commandments. We wanted to follow other gods in our heart. We still had the gods of Egypt in our heart. Save Caleb, the son of Jephunneh, he shall see it. And to him will I give the land that he hath trodden upon, and to his children, because he hath wholly followed the Lord. So the Most High said, Caleb, he's coming in. Caleb was one out of the two that from the original stock that came out of Egypt that made it into the land of Israel. Because Caleb, he kept the commandments. He didn't go off and do his own thing. He stuck within the guidelines. He didn't fall for the trap. Remember, the 40 years in the wilderness was all, that was a test. Caleb didn't fall for it. Also, the Lord was angry with me for your sake, saying, thou shalt not go in thither. But what happened to Moses? He didn't even make it into the land of Israel. Moses did all these miracles. He did all this work to get the children of Israel out of Egypt. And guess what? All that because he didn't endure to the end. That's why the scriptures tell you he that endured to the end. Moses didn't make it. He made it close to the end, but he disobeyed the Most High. He did his own thing. And he for that, the Most High said, the Most High had him go up on a mountain. He said, look to the east, the west, the north, the south. He said, look at all this beautiful land. Guess what? You're not going in. That's what he told Moses. Moses just got to see the land with his eyes, but he didn't pass the test. So he didn't get to go in, as great as he was. But Joshua, the son of Nun, which standeth before thee, he shall go in thither. Encourage him, for he shall cause Israel to inherit it. Moreover, your little ones, which ye said should be a prey, and your children, which in that day had no knowledge between good and evil, they shall go in thither, and unto them will I give it, and they shall possess it. So who got to go into the land? It was Joshua and Caleb from the original stock. They're the only ones that bridged the gap from Egypt to the land of Israel. Nobody else made it. Everybody else got the Most High killed. He killed everyone in the wilderness. That's the whole point of the 40 years. That many people did not pass the test when the Most High left us in the wilderness to prove us if we would keep his commandments. We didn't follow it. But he let the new generation, the ones of those that came from Egypt that had kids, he let all their kids come into the land with Joshua and Caleb. So now we're coming into the land with a new generation of people. And now we're going in there to possess it. And watch how the Most High still gonna have a test for these people that go in. Nobody is left without a test. It's all a test to see where your heart is gonna be at. So watch what happens next once we get into the land with this new generation of people. Judges chapter 3, verse 1. Now these are the nations which the Lord left to prove Israel by them. The Most High, when we came into the land of Israel, we were knocking off nations left and right. We were knocking off many nations, but the Most High purposely left nations in there to prove us, and it's going to explain as we go down. He left nations on purpose. That's why all the inhabitants of the land of Israel never got pushed out of that land. He did that on purpose. It's not that because we didn't have enough power to get these nations out. The Most High left them there on purpose to prove us or to test us. Watch. Namely, five lords of the Philistines and all the Canaanites and the Sidonians and the Hivites that dwell in Mount Lebanon, from Mount Baal Hermon unto the entering in of Hamath. And they were to prove Israel by them, to know whether they would hearken unto the commandments of the Lord, which he commanded their fathers by the hand of Moses. This is the reason why he left those nations, to see if we're gonna listen to what he commanded us in the wilderness. He wants to see where your heart is really at. He's looking down. He's like, I'm gonna leave these Canaanites and these other nations in the land, because I want to see what these children of Israel are going to do. I want to know where their heart is genuinely at. If they're going to keep my commandments, or if they're going to look at the Canaanites and these other people and how they worship their gods, and they're going to be curious and start dabbling into the other nations' philosophies. I want to see what they're going to do. So the Most High is just sitting back and it's on his throne. He's like, let me see what's going to happen.
And the children of Israel dwelt among the Canaanites, Hittites and Amorites and the Perizzites and Hivites and Jebusites. And they took their daughters to be their wives and gave their daughters to their sons and served their gods.
And we started giving our sons and our daughters over to the Canaanites and the Hivites and these other ancient, these are authentic Africans. These are Africans that come from the seed of Ham. As soon as we came into the land, the first thing we start doing is mixing amongst the Africans. We started taking their daughters, we start giving them our daughters, they start taking our sons, and vice versa. The Most High told us in Deuteronomy 7, he told us not to give our daughters over to these nations, because these nations were dabbling in other types of philosophies that were against what the Most High commanded us to do. They were dealing with homosexuality, witchcraft, Satan worship. They were dealing with all that, burning and sacrificing their kids in the fire. They were dealing with all these evils that the Most High said for us not to be doing. And we started serving their gods. We started getting curious. Well, let me see what these guys are doing over here, the Canaanites. Oh, that looks interesting right there. That the Canaanite God says that they don't have to keep any laws. That they can just go off and do whatever they want. That's what that God says. I like that God right there. So I'm gonna go do that. Follow me, people.
And the children of Israel did evil in the sight of the Lord, and forget the Lord their God, and serve Baalim and the groves.
And we forgot the Most High, and we start serving everyone else's gods. That's what we did. Out of curiosity, because it's appealing. All the gods of the nations have appealing gods. For some reason, we always don't want to serve the God of the Hebrews. We always want to go serve somebody else's gods. They're appealing. Like the God of Christianity, that God is appealing to a lot of our people and a lot of people out there in the world. It's very appealing. He tells you don't have to keep any commandments. He tells you can do whatever you want. It's a free-for-all. So it's all the gods of the nations have always been appealing.
Therefore, the anger of the Lord was hot against Israel, and he sold them into the hand of Chusharishathaim, king of Mesopotamia. And the children of Israel served Chusharishathaim 8 years.
So since we didn't want to listen to the Most High, he sent the king of Mesopotamia to come down there and start enslaving us. This was the beginning. This is the first captivity in the land of Israel. After we just came out of captivity in Egypt. Soon as we got into the land, slavery. Because we don't want to listen. We're always trying to go after somebody else's gods, and we never want to listen to the Most High's commandments. That's how we ended up in all the various captivities, and eventually into the last captivity today, starting with the in the transatlantic slave trade. That's how we ended up here. Not obeying and listening to somebody else, trying to move us away from the commandments. So you can see clearly that the Most High continues, he puts tests out there to see how we're gonna deal with these tests, how we're gonna deal with these circumstances. He always puts them out there. It even goes beyond this. It goes all the way back to Adam. When he made Adam, he didn't just give Adam rein and let him do whatever he want. He gave him a choice. He put the tree of knowledge of good and evil in the midst there. Now, did the Most High have to put that tree there? No, but he put it there to test Adam to see where his heart was at. Everything is a test. He wants to see what you're going to do. He don't want to make the decision for you. He wants to see what you are going to do. What are you going to do when something that is against what he told you to do is appealing? What is your heart going to tell you to do? And what is your reactions going to be? You can see that we have always failed the test that the Most High has put out there. Always. And it gets better. It's going to show you that the Most High had more in store for us. Follow along.
Jeremiah 6 verse 19. Hear, O earth, behold, I will bring evil upon this people, even the fruit of their thoughts, because they have not hearkened unto my words, nor to my law, but rejected it.
The Most High said he was going to bring evil upon this people. What people? He's talking about the children of Israel. Evil upon this people because we continue to not want to listen to the Most High's commandments. It's repetitive. It's the same thing over and over. We keep finding new ways to get out of listening to the Most High's commandments. So he said he's going to bring evil. What was the evil that he ended up bringing? The many captivities and slavery. That's the evil that the Most High brings. Black on black crime and hatred amongst his own people. That's the evil that he brought. Ghettos, poverty, welfare. This is the evil that he brought because we didn't want to listen and we never passed his test. When he proved us, when he was leaving things out there, obstacles out there to prove us.
To what purpose cometh there to me incense from Sheba and the sweet came from a far country? Your burnt offerings are not acceptable, nor your sacrifices sweet unto me.
The Most High didn't want any burnt offerings. He didn't want any of that because we were worshiping him with lip service, but we didn't want to keep no commandments. We were playing the role from the the outer looked like we were playing the role, but within, we wasn't keeping no commandments, and we didn't desire to. We wanted to follow everyone else. Therefore, thus saith the Lord, behold, I will lay stumbling blocks before this people. The Most High says, I will lay stumbling blocks. I will, referring to a future prophecy, or it's a future tense. What is a stumbling block? It's something used to keep your way to the destination where you're trying to get. So everyone's trying to get to the kingdom of heaven. The Most High says he's going to put stumbling blocks, meaning things that would be in the path to the kingdom, inside of our way. And many people are gonna fall into these stumbling blocks, and they'll never get to the end or their destination. Their destination will stop at that stumbling block, and they'll eventually fall into the lake of fire. So he says he will put stumbling blocks. Watch. And the fathers and the sons together shall fall upon them. The neighbor and his friend shall perish. He says that these stumbling blocks, plural, meaning it's going to be more than one stumbling block. It's going to be many stumbling blocks. But the people that fall into these stumbling blocks, they're not going to be able to get out. They're going to perish. Why? Because remember, it's all because of the intentions of your heart. It's your own actions that's going to get you there. That's going to have you fall. It's your own actions. And I'm about to show you, we're going to push further into the New Testament, and I'm going to show you that Paul, his writing was one of those stumbling blocks. His writings were one of these stumbling blocks that the Most High purposely put there to prove you, to see if you would keep his commandments or no. The Most High purposely put it there. I'm going to call to the witness right now, the Apostle Peter, to show you that he himself knew that the writings of Paul was a stumbling block, and it was going to be a lot of people that fall into it to their own death. Their own heart was going to deceive them into falling into these stumbling blocks. 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 15. An account that the long suffering of our Lord is salvation, even as our beloved brother Paul, also according to the wisdom given unto him, have written unto you, as also in all his epistles, speaking in them of things in which are some things hard to be understood. So what is Peter telling you right now? Remember, Peter is the head apostle right now. He was given the keys directly from Christ. He's the head apostle, and he's telling you right now. He said, the brother Paul, he's writing some things in his epistles that are very hard to be understood. Meaning that when they look at Paul's letters, they're having to examine all the lines that he's writing to find out what Paul is really saying. Because on the surface, it looks like he's saying one thing, but you have to dig deep to find out what Paul is really saying. That's what he's saying. And remember, this is 2,000 years ago. This is 2,000 years ago, and they're in the same setting as Paul, so you would think that they would be able to understand Paul a lot better than someone 2,000 years after Paul. And if they're saying it's hard during that time, imagine how hard it is for people during this time to understand them. And you got people creating a whole doctrine from Paul's epistles. Follow me. Which they that are unlearned and unstable rest, as they do also the other scriptures, unto their own destruction. Peter says those that are unlearned, these are unlearned men and women dabbling in Paul's writings. When he says unlearned, meaning you don't know none of the other scriptures. You don't know anything about the law, the prophets. You don't have any history to draw from, and you dabbling with Paul's writings. He said it's going to be to your own destruction. That's the stumbling block that the Most High said he was going to put out. And Peter's letting you know that it's going to be a lot of people that fall to their own destruction. Now, why is it your own destruction? Because during the time of judgment, you're not going to stand. You're not going to come to the stand and say, let me call Paul up here to help me out. You can't call Paul to help you out and say, well, Paul said this. No, it's to your own destruction. That's why the Most High left. He put the Spirit on Peter to put this in his writings. So there would be no excuse. There would be no excuse. Now, as Paul, this is not to say that Paul is purposely doing this. Paul didn't purposely write the way he wrote to purposely throw people off. I'm quite sure that he didn't know that his letters that were sent to churches would be taken and put in books, and then doctrines would be created out of it. I'm pretty sure he didn't know that. I'm pretty sure that was not his intent to blow up and be a foundation of 2-point-something billion people that will follow his writings and don't have a clue at what he's saying. What we're gonna do, I'm gonna get ready to go in and show you some of these stumbling blocks in Paul's writings, how the Most High gave you, he's gonna give you two choices with Paul's writings. Because Paul goes, sometimes it seems like he's telling you to go against certain things, but on another scripture, he'll tell you, don't go against it. So the Most High purposely put him in there to prove you, to see where your heart is at. Follow me, watch this.
Romans chapter 6, verse 14. For sin shall not have dominion over you, for ye are not under the law, but under grace.
This is when you see a Christian jump out of their seat hollering amen. They'll holler amen quick for this verse. You tell, anytime you have a discussion with a Christian and you they want to tell you and show you that the laws are done away with, not 100% of the time they're going to run to one of the letters of Paul. 100, showing you that they don't have any understanding. They're always going to go to the letters of Paul and try to show and twist Paul's words and show you that we don't have to keep no laws, brother, we under grace. When this has nothing to do with that. But watch the next verse and we'll see and see if somebody jump up and say amen to this. Remember, the Most High always gives you two choices. He gives you two choices. So this one sounds like we don't have to keep no commandments at all. But watch what happens when you read the next verse. And this, remember, it's all to prove you, to see whether you, whether your heart is gonna allow you to keep his commandments or no. He's sitting back looking at you like, let me see what this man is going to do. Watch what happens when we read the next verse. And we'll see where your heart is really at.
What then? Shall we sin because we are not under the law but under grace? God forbid.
Paul says, shall we sin? Sin, according to 1 John 5 verse 3, means breaking God's laws. So every time you see the word sin, it means going against the commandments that the Most High laid out in the first 5 books of Moses. That's what sin is according to the Bible. So Paul says, shall we just start breaking God's laws, getting up and breaking all his laws because we're not under the law, we're under grace? God forbid. That means no. He says, no, you're not supposed to be doing that. You're not supposed to be doing that. You don't use grace as an excuse to start breaking God's laws. So now you got to reevaluate the verse prior. You got to find out, okay, what does he mean by this? What is he saying? He's not telling you that you don't have to keep the law. I'm going to give you an example of what he means, that you're not under the law, you're under grace. When Christ and the disciples came from preaching the gospel and it was the Sabbath day and they were hungry, they started picking the corn. It's unlawful to do any work. According to the law, it's unlawful to do any work on the Sabbath day. But since these brothers were hungry, they were exercising grace. The Most High is not some robot up in the sky and doesn't have any type of intellectual capacity. He understands if somebody's hungry, if it's the Sabbath day, brother, get some food. If you don't have no food, especially you've been preaching the gospel, you don't have any food at the time, you was preaching the word and you didn't get a chance to prepare any food, brother, get some food. That's what he means, you're not under the law. The law says you can't do nothing. So if you were under the law, that means you'd be sitting there looking like a fool on the Sabbath day with your stomach growling. You waiting for the sun to go down. You looking around waiting for the sun to go down. Grace, that's what he says. You're not under the law, you're under grace. That's what he means by that. But then when you read the next verse, shall we sin because we're not under the law? Christ and them wasn't grabbing corn and bundling it up to go sell it at the market next week. They wasn't just using grace as an excuse to start breaking God's laws for no reason. It was a reason why they had to extend the law of the Sabbath. They had to go outside of the boundaries on the Sabbath day because them brothers were hungry. You're not going to sit there on the Sabbath day and you see somebody dead or dying on the floor and you say, brother, it's the Sabbath day. I'm sorry, I can't do no work. You're a doctor. I can't do no work. I got to wait for the sun to go down. When the sun drop, then I can go ahead and help you. That's what he means. You're not under the law. The law is not made to have somebody in a cage. It's a guideline. It's a guideline. Sometimes things happen where you might have to go outside the guideline, but then you come right back in and go right back on the guideline of keeping the commandments. That's all he's saying, that you're not under the law, you're under grace. That's it. It's as simple as that. And this concept of grace is not something new invented by Paul. It's not something that Paul just woke up one day and said, you know what, grace. You can see, you can read about grace all the way back in Genesis. All throughout the Bible, there's grace. All throughout the Bible. That's why you're not supposed to be dealing with Paul's letters until you have understood all the previous chapters in the Bible. This is the last section of the Bible you're supposed to be dealing with. The last one. That's why Peter told you it's going to be to your own destruction. And the Most High wants to know where your heart is really at.
Galatians 5 verse 17. For the flesh lusteth against the spirit, and the spirit against the flesh. And these are contrary the one to the other, so that ye cannot do the things that ye would.
So Paul is telling you that the flesh and the spirit, it's a war going on. They're contrary. The flesh, the outly man, this thing wants to do all the lust and despicable things. But the spirit inside wants to do something contrary. What he's referring to really is keeping God's commandments. The spirit wants to keep God's commandments, but the lust, or the lust of the flesh, is trying to tell you, go do something else.
But if ye be led of the Spirit, ye are not under the law.
This, once again, is where you see the Christians fly up out of their seats with an amen. See, brother, I'm led of the Spirit. I'm not under no law. I don't have to keep no law. I'm led of the Spirit. Well, Brother Charles, didn't I just see you last week coming out of Chippendales, the strip club? Didn't I just see your car pulling out of there? Did the Spirit lead you there? Did the Spirit lead you there? Now I gotta ask you, well, what spirit are you led by? Because it just said this, if you're led by the Spirit. Well, what spirit? There's many spirits. He's talking about the Spirit of Christ. If you're led by the Spirit of Christ, you're not under the law. The same example that we already gave, or that I already gave in the last verse. You're not under the law. The Spirit of Christ is not, you're not gonna be under the law. You're gonna be doing the things already. Your spirit is already gonna tell you to keep the commandments. So the law, you don't have to go through and just be reading laws and be bound by a law. The Spirit already, if you got the Spirit of Christ in you, you're gonna be keeping the commandments already.
Now the works of the flesh are manifest, which are these.
Now Paul's about to tell you what the works of the flesh are, and you're gonna find out which spirit you're led by. Watch.
Adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, variance, emulation, wrath, strife, sedition, heresies, envyings, murders, drunkenness, revelings, and such like.
Guess where all these come from, people? All these come from the law. All these come from the law. So that's telling you, if you're doing any of these things, you're not led by the Spirit. All these things come from the law. The witchcraft, all that stuff you're not supposed to be doing, dabbling in that stuff. That all comes from the law. Paul's telling you right now, if you're doing these in the flesh, you're not led by the Spirit. He's speaking in codes. Remember, he's speaking to other people that have a high intellectual capacity, and they have the same, at least a similar amount of knowledge as he does regarding the law. So if you're doing this, you're not led by the Spirit. The Spirit of Christ, you're going to be keeping the commandments, and you're not going to be doing these things. That's what he's saying. He's not saying you don't have to keep no commandments because you're led by the Spirit. Well, what spirit?
Of the which I tell you before, as I have told you in times past, that they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God.
Paul's letting you know, if you ain't keeping God's commandments, you can forget about getting in the kingdom of God. You can forget about it. That's what Paul's letting you know. So the Most High put that stumbling block there with the verse talking about, if you be led by the Spirit, you're not under the law. He put that right there on purpose. And then he gave you a choice at the bottom of it, as you keep reading. He says, let me see which one of these people are gonna pick. Let me see what all these people are gonna pick, where their heart is really at. That's what he's doing. He's sitting back looking. Most people are gonna stick right at that. See, I'm led by the Spirit. I don't need to do anything else. I'm led by the Spirit, brother. I don't know about you, but I'm led by the Spirit. Yep, the Spirit got me doing, even though that Spirit that they led by got them doing all kind of wickedness, all types of wickedness, they're gonna tell you they're led by the Spirit. And they're not gonna continue reading down and getting an understanding on what this Spirit is talking about. This is what the Most High is dealing with. The Most High is dealing with stumbling blocks, and this is one of them. And there's plenty of stumbling blocks in the writings of Paul that you should not be dabbling with if you don't have a clear foundation in the Old Testament. That's what the Most High is dealing with. If you don't have a clear understanding about keeping the commandments, from Genesis all the way up to the time of Christ, everyone told you you had to keep the commandments. How all of a sudden you jump to Paul and Paul preaching another gospel from everyone else? All of a sudden Paul's preaching this totally different gospel that you won't find anywhere else in the Old Testament. It's not that he's preaching a different gospel. It's that you're choosing to not want to hear to what he's really saying. And you don't have the knowledge to be able to break down what he's saying. So the Most High has a stumbling block there for you and for the rest of all the other people who are gonna get trapped in the Paul's writings. That's what he does. And it's not anything against Paul at all. Like I said, Paul is a sincere brother. He's a sincere brother. I'm pretty sure if he knew his letters would have been used at this wide of a scale, he would have not have written them the way that they were, the way that they are formatted today. He would have not have done that. So the Most High has a stumbling block out here in his letters. And there's plenty more of them that we'll go through in further lessons. But now what I'm going to show you is when you run across Paul's letters, if you're dabbling across his letters, a way that you will always be safe, there's two scriptures I'm going to bring out. You'll always be safe and you'll never fall into the stumbling block if you stick to these two scriptures when you run across something that you might not understand. Like this, like when you run across scriptures like we just went over, you might run across these and you might just be clear and you might not understand them. Always stick to these two scriptures and you will not fall into the stumbling block that the Most High has laid out for the children of wicked men. 1 Corinthians 11 verse 1. Be ye followers of me, even as I also am of Christ. Paul's letting you know, I follow the Messiah. I'm not coming with no new gospel. This is not my own gospel that I'm creating. I follow the Messiah. So now we got to take Paul. This is clear. This is clear. So now we got to take Paul and we got to take this verse into consideration every time we read one of Paul's writings. And now we got to find out, well, what did the Messiah say? Let's go and find out what he says, because when you read the Gospels, you're going to find out it is clear. There's a lot of parables in it that people don't understand. But when Christ speaks concerning the law, he is clear about it. He didn't come to do away with no law. He's very clear. So you go to this verse, and now we go to what Christ says. Matthew chapter 5, verse 17. Think not that I am come to destroy the law or the prophets. What does think not mean? That means don't get it inside of your mind. Don't try to put my name in any doctrine teaching that the laws are done away with. That's what Christ is telling you. That's what he's telling you, because he knew people in the last days would start preaching about you don't have to keep no laws. No, don't put my name in that at all, is what he's saying. I am not come to destroy, but to fulfill. Christ came to fulfill the things that were written about him in the law and in the prophets. So if he destroyed the law or the prophets, he'd be getting rid of himself. He'd be destroying himself, because he's written all in the law and in the prophets. For verily I say unto you, till heaven and earth pass, one jot or one tittle shall in no wise pass from the law till all be fulfilled. Everything written about Christ must be fulfilled, and it has not been fulfilled. There's prophecies about his next return. There's prophecies about him having an everlasting kingdom. There's prophecies about him taking down all the kingdoms of the world. There's prophecies about him setting up the children of Israel in a government of the kingdom of heaven. These have not been fulfilled. So he says, till heaven and earth pass, nothing is going to pass from the law at all. These bear witness. Heaven and earth bear witness. And they're still here today. We can look up. We can look down. They're still here today. So that means the law didn't go nowhere. If you believe in Christ, this is why I say they don't preach the doctrine of Christ, because this is plain as day. This is clear as day.
Whosoever therefore shall break one of these least commandments and shall teach men so, he shall be called least in the kingdom of heaven.
There goes your Christian church right there. That's where y'all aiming for. A lot of you out there. This is not all this, because there's some sincere Christians out there who really want to learn. And these videos are for you. There's some that really want to learn, but the majority of them, they don't want to learn. They just want to be lawless and do their own thing and worship their own gods and just use the Bible as a cover-up. He says, I'm telling you, if you're teaching that and you're teaching, if you're doing no commandments and you're teaching men that they don't have to keep no commandments, he said, you're going to be called least in the kingdom of heaven. You're going to have a low spot.
But whosoever shall do and teach them, the same shall be called great in the kingdom of heaven.
If you're doing the commandments and keeping the commandments, and you're teaching people to keep the commandments, you are aiming for a great spot in the kingdom of heaven. Why they don't teach that in a Christian church? If we're supposed to be following Christ, why this verse don't come out in the Christian church? Because you're not following Christ. You're following misinterpretations of Paul's writings. 2.something billion people deceived because of misinterpretations of Paul's writings. And the Most High put that stumbling block there on purpose. Now let's find out one of these laws that you must keep and not twisting and to do your own will.
Leviticus 19 verse 28. Ye shall not make any cuttings in your flesh for the dead, nor print any marks upon you. I am the Lord.
No tattoos. You're not supposed to be doing that. You're not supposed to be carving in your skin, because the body is the temple. You're not supposed to be doing that. I'm gonna ask you, are we supposed to be doing that? Can we do, is that a law that's hard to keep? Or some of you just have to go get a tattoo? You see what I'm saying? The Most High wanna see where your heart is at. That's what it all boils down to. He wanna see where the children of men's heart is at. He wants to know the inner thoughts of each man. So he left these writings of Paul there purposely. He had a spirit put on Paul to write in this format, and he want to know what each and every one of you are about. He wants to know it. That's why it tells you that the gate, that broad is the way that leadeth to destruction, and many are going to go into that. But the gate that leads to the kingdom of heaven, he says, few are going to find it. Because the stumbling blocks that he put out, everyone's going to fall over that. Everyone's going to fall over that. So right now is your opportunity. If you got to take this lesson, listen to it, be attentive to it, and use these as tools to not fall into the stumbling blocks. I'm telling you right now, you got to keep the commandments and follow Christ. That's your ticket to the way to the kingdom of heaven. There's no other way. There's no other way. Anything that's going to get you against that, or as contrary to that, that you might perceive that way, leave it alone. You might not have a full understanding on it, and it's taking you into a different path. So with that, I'm going to say shalom. With the next videos that I'm going to bring out, we're going to go into a few of the topics that are major stumbling blocks with the Christian church. And I'm going to give you some of these tools through the Spirit of the Most High for you to be able to jump out of that, if your heart is pure. With that, I say shalom until next time, and peace.